Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. A new scientific study has provided a jolt of surprising data on what was thought to be the largest and oldest impact crater on the Moon. The lunar South Pole Aitken Basin is roughly 2,500 kilometers in diameter and 13 kilometers deep, which makes it one of the largest so-called impact craters in the entire solar system. Scientists had theorized that the basin contained minerals from the Moon's mantle, since a tremendous kinetic energy from the hypothetical impact would have pierced the lunar crust and brought the materials to the surface. However, a team of scientists studying data from the Chinese spacecraft Chang'e 4's rover have found that in reality, the predominant mineral in the basin is common in the lunar soil. Thus, they have not found the materials required of such a tremendous impact site. The co-author of a new scientific study published in the Geophysical Research Letters says of the findings, "We are not seeing the mantle materials at the landing site as expected." A phys.org report on the discovery states, "The new study complicates theories about how the oldest, largest crater on the Moon formed, adding to the body of knowledge about the Moon's history. The new study complicates the certainty of earlier findings and points toward a need for continued research on the far side's lunar surface." Of course, the complication of scientific theories is inevitable if only one theory is considered. A striking example of so-called settled science, which was settled prematurely, is the question of how the Moon got its craters. As we entered the space age, the debate among geologists and astronomers had only considered two hypotheses, impacts and volcanism. After Apollo astronauts returned lunar samples to Earth, analysis revealed a tremendous portion of the material was composed of shocked and welded minerals. Thus, the impact origin of lunar craters became the consensus scientific theory and remains so today. But like so much settled science, the dilemma was settled without the successful resolution of countless anomalies. Why the Moon is so heavily cratered is itself a puzzle which still demands a satisfactory answer. The Moon and some other bodies in the solar system are so heavily cratered that astronomers invented a violent epoch called the Late Heavy Bombardment, a period when disproportionate numbers of asteroids supposedly collided with planets in the inner solar system. One reason for the hypothesis is that isotopic dating of moon rocks seems to imply that the so-called impacts caused rocks to melt over a relatively short time. But problems with the late heavy bombardment hypothesis abound, and mainstream science continues to debate where the impacting bodies could have come from. Astronomers have long believed that asteroids were the source of the hypothetical bombardment. However, in 2017, the scientific paper Modeling the Historical Flux of Planetary Impactors acknowledges that, quote, "asteroids were probably not responsible for the late heavy bombardment." The authors instead call on planetary migration in the early solar system and propose that, quote, "comets and leftovers of the terrestrial planet formation provided additional and probably dominant source of impacts during early epochs." Unfortunately, mainstream scientists today seem unaware that a sound scientific foundation exists for an entirely different hypothesis of cratering on the Moon and other rocky bodies. In fact, in 1965, the amateur astronomer Brian J. Ford published his laboratory experiments suggesting that craters on the Moon were carved by cosmic lightning bolts. In the cited experiments, Ford used a spark machining apparatus to reproduce in miniature some of the most puzzling lunar features, including craters with central peaks, small craters preferentially perched on the high rims of larger craters, and craters strung out in long chains. He also observed that the ratio of large to small craters on the Moon matched the ratio seen in electrical arcing, and as with craters seen elsewhere in the solar system, Ford remarked on the mystery of their typical extreme circularity. He noted that over 90% of lunar craters cannot have been produced by side-swiping impacts. So planetary scientists concluded that the kinetic energy of an impactor must simply be converted into powerful surface explosions. However, highly circular craters are routinely produced in the industrial process of electrical discharge machining. many years before Ford's published experiments, and long before the Apollo missions to the moon. Dr. Emanuel Velikovsky had made the outrageous prediction that remnant magnetism would be found in the lunar rocks. Astronomers had completely rejected the idea, since the moon today has only a very weak magnetic field and is believed to have been geologically dead for a billion years. But Velikovsky based his prediction on his hypothesis of recent planetary catastrophe, involving interplanetary lightning between celestial bodies. Of course, like several other outrageous predictions by Velikovsky, it was proven correct. Velikovsky's colleague, the engineer Ralph Jurgens, also provided a remarkable analysis which should have been included in the scientific debate on the moon's history and geological features. One of the most puzzling features on the moon is the sinuous rill, which is a long, winding valley, usually with steep walls and often emerging from a crater. This feature is pervasive on the moon at dramatically different scales. Prior to the Apollo missions, astronomers' early hypotheses suggested that the rills were, quote, cracks on the moon's surface. Later guesses included flowing water, until scientists settled on flowing lava as the agent. Today, the accepted theory is that the moon's sinuous rills were created either by lava flowing across the surface or beneath the ground to form a, quote, lava tube, portions of which eventually collapsed. Jurgens compared the respective point-by-point requirements of various competing theories versus the actual observed characteristics of the rills. Unlike planetary scientists, Jurgens included among the possible agents high-energy electrical discharge. On every evidentiary point, the electrical discharge hypothesis is either permissible or predictable. And unlike every competing hypothesis, in not a single instance does the evidence preclude electrical discharge as the cause of the rills. Even prior to Jurgens' investigation, several scientists had noted that flowing liquids, whether water or lava, could not have caused the observed features of the lunar rills, including the strings of craters along the rills' floors. These points are dramatically emphasized when we examine the moon's famous Hadley rill. Today, planetary scientists agree that the rill is a, quote, collapsed lava tube. However, the rill does not match the required characteristics of lava tubes on numerous points. Most importantly, the collapsed areas of a lava tube will be rubble-filled depressions. High-resolution images of the rill reveal no rubble and no collapsed tubes. It is simply an empty, sharply cut channel, which matches the expected characteristics of an electrical, quote, breakdown channel. Perhaps the greatest problem for the volcanic hypothesis of lunar rills is their tremendous length. On our own planet, the longest lava tube reaches only 65 kilometers. That is about half the length of Hadley Rill, which is 130 kilometers. However, the exact opposite should be true. On Earth, the atmosphere is insulating, allowing lava to retain its heat. In the near-perfect vacuum of space, heat will be much more rapidly radiated away. On our planet, as lava flows over distances no more than tens of kilometers, the cooling at the surface causes a roof to form. It may then continue to flow as a tube beneath the surface. That is the only way the lava tubes can achieve even their modest lengths. Consider then the most prominent lunar rill, called Schroeder's Valley, 185 kilometers long and up to 10 kilometers wide, with its depth at points reaching up to 1,300 meters. Flowing lava eating away surface material to cut a deep channel would have to show up somewhere. We should see either breaches in the deep walls or evidence of abundant outflow. Instead, the channel simply dwindles until it disappears. Curiously, the flow of rills on the moon and other worlds isn't limited to downhill, like lava and water-carved channels on Earth. All fluid erosion theories for Schroeder's Valley have chosen to ignore that the apparent mouth of the, quote, stream is on high ground, and the narrowest part of the channel is on low ground. We also note that within Schroeder's Valley is a much more narrow secondary rill, whose defining feature is a chain of small craters. If the moon was indeed ravaged by high-energy electrical discharge, nothing found in decades of lunar studies is inconsistent with the hypothesis. This includes the discovery of glass spherules, chondrules, and minerals formed at high temperatures, typically associated with volcanic lightning, found in abundance in the lunar soil. It includes the stunning disparity in cratering between the moon's far side, which is massively cratered, and the Earth-facing near side, which is far less cratered and with considerably less crustal thickness, a disparity which calls to mind the equally baffling Martian hemispheric dichotomy, and similar dichotomy seen on many other rocky bodies. And it includes the many types of craters seen throughout the solar system which are difficult or even impossible to explain through the impact hypothesis. From the aforementioned puzzle of smaller craters consistently appearing on the rims of larger craters, to crater chains, weird hexagonal craters, and craters with cleanly cut floors free of any ejecta from an explosive impact. As we've exhaustively outlined for 7 years on this series, all of these types of craters are routinely seen in experiments with electrical discharge. In the early space age, the moon was a symbol of mankind overcoming his physical restriction to planet Earth, as well as extending the reach of his knowledge of the cosmos. Yet today, as in all of the theoretical space sciences, we see an immense disconnect between popular theory and the revelations of discovery. A disconnect which can only be resolved by a willingness to explore entirely new possibilities. More than half a century has passed since the first footstep on the moon, and the possibility still exists for a, quote, giant leap toward a truer understanding of the moon's history and origins.